name's Guadalupe Herrera, and I was born in 1940 in a town of Monte Alto, Texas.
Ventura Felix Herrera, born in 1941, Edcouch, Texas.
I'm Rojelio Herrera. I was born December 7, 1942, in La Villa, Texas.
Well, hi, my name's Greg Herrera. I was born in Edcouch, Texas, in May 9, 1944.
Hey, my name is Dominga Herrera, and I was born in November 4, 1945, and in Edcouch, Texas.
Petrita Herrera. I was born January 18, 1947, in Edcouch, Texas.
Juanita Herrera, I was the second youngest of the Herrera family. I was born in La Villa, Texas, in 1950, January the 3rd.
Okay, my name is Santos Nunez. I'm the youngest of the family, and I was born in Edcouch.
Ya no quiero que me beses, ni besarte, ni mirarte, ni siquiera oír tu voz.
Edcouch was a small town, maybe population around 2,000. It only had one traffic light, maybe two or three gas stations, but it had a lot of bars, a lot of cantinas, we used to call it, just about one in each block. And if you drove, or when my parents drove, they would hear the music because the doors were open. You could hear music from the bars, you know. Very happy or town, you know, and only one theater, no bowling alley or anything.
That's pretty good because, we first started, actually, we grew up mostly going to La Villa, which is a town close to Edcouch. And we lived on the farm. My dad, he was a foreman at this ranch, and it was a pretty good life because growing up, I always made some slingshots and stuff like that, and went hunting birds and went fishing. So a lot of running around to do, played marbles, mm-hmm. tops, everything. And I think it was fun life.
So the midwife is usually a lady that comes to the house and deliver babies. You know, in those times there was no money for hospitals, no insurance. So she would come to the house. They probably, I don't know how much she would charge, but that's the person that delivered babies. All of them, I guess, were born in the house.
Okay.
Somewhere, you know, but in a house, not at the hospitals.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think it was the same lady. And they used to call her in Spanish the wifen. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. The wifen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, I remember from my younger sister how she was, they bring in the midwife to deliver her. And it was at the house. And I remember the first, right away, they had to feed her a bottle. You know, usually they wait, give him just sugar water nowadays. But her, they had to give her a bottle of milk right away.
And my brother, Greg, you know, and I, we used to, we had a mesquite tree that was pretty tall. We used to climb the tree there, and we would spend most of the day there. You know, when we weren't going to school, we would spend the whole day just playing there and you know, playing outside. We didn't get in any trouble because there was nothing that we could damage or anything like that. So it was we had a lot of fun, you know. And sometimes we would make slingshots for entertainment and, you know, use them for practice on either cans or something that we could shoot with. So it was a lot of fun. Yeah, the electricity, we didn't have electricity. We didn't have any heaters like for the winter time. We would use mostly like a kerosene heater. It was a kerosene heater that I remember that for the winter time. And as far as running water, there was no such thing as running water.
You could, you know, feel the air coming in. And I still recall where the window was and our bed. Well, no one will. The Christmas tree here, you know, I really do. And I still can, you know, visualize that house because we also had a well. That's it. And then we had one of those water pump, you know, to get our water. And we had to put water in that water pump, you know, for drinking water for us. And then also being that there was no washing machine to wash our clothes, we used to have one of those. Well, first it was Minga that would wash the clothes, you know, with those washing boards, you know, pen. And then along came one of those washing machine, those rangers, the one you would go around and around, put the clothes in there. And we used to take a shower también in a little room behind there. We would put in a curtain there. And then, oh, yes, I do remember we used to, because we didn't have no hot water or, you know, not a regular shower, ¿verdad? So then we would outside, we'd had a big pail of the water, you know, so it would get warm, you know, so that we would pour ourselves in it. But, you know, that was where we washed our clothes and took a bath, you know.
The bathroom, that's a different story. We had an outhouse. Me and Minga, we were the oldest one girls. You know, we would go up there. We liked to smoke at the time. We were little, we would get brown paper bags, we would roll them up and pretend they were cigarettes. We would lock ourselves in the bathroom and would start smoking. And then Greg would come up, Mom, look at the girls, they're smoking, Mom.
Well, it was a poor house, you know, we had a bed with all four or five sleep in it, and then that one, or my sister's sleep, and we just put a curtain, you know. They separated. Let's say we were poor, you know. And Mom, she does anything she could do, you know, to help us out. Like our steak for us was like a chicken. She would get a chicken, grab it by the neck, and spin it around, and make a cross. Then all of a sudden it died.
We used to make dolls made out of those 2x4 sticks, and we'd put like a diaper on it, you know. But to cover the wood, like a diaper, like that. We used hands, another diaper for hands, arms, everything. Yeah, I do remember we used to do that. And actually, I think my mom said that my dad bought me a doll for one of my birthdays, and it was big. But I let somebody play with it, one of the neighbors, and they had an accident on it. So my dad got mad and he threw it away.
The house that I most remember is there used to be a house that had a swing outside. And my most experience that I'll never forget is when I was young, there was a little old man that every day, once a week, he would go get his groceries, and he would walk by our house, pull a little red wagon. And every time I saw him, he would wave at me. So I knew when coming back, he was going to bring, he always knew my favorite candies was those little corn candies.
We got some trees, and we kind of shave it off and make our horses, and we put a rope and tie and run like a horse, you know. That was one of our favorites in our team that we used to play. And most of the time we played was barefooted, you know. I ran all over all that stickers and everything. If they bother, I just scratch them, take off again.
Since we lived out in the farm, okay, we used to raise chickens and cows. And I remembered I used to have this little chicken that I used to play. So. Okay, we used to have rabbits too, so I decided to put my chicken there with the rabbit. Then when I went back to pick my little chicken, the little pig was missing, and I cried so much, and that has, you know, got me so, why I did that? I just didn't want to lose my chicken, so that was the best that I could do, you know. But another thing that I do remember was on Christmas too, in the same little house, this Christmas, the Salvation Army came over to our house, the red truck came over at Christmas. We had it's a little house, and we had this little Christmas tree like the Charlie Brown, but, you know, we liked the little tree. He brought us some tricycle, little red tricycle, and a little red wagon. And then I remember, okay, they even gave us a little stocking, the net, a little red net. And in there it had a coloring book, and it had crayons, an apple, and that old-fashioned hard candy. And then, of course, being that my mom was very, you know, Sundays, you know, church. Well, again, midnight mass. I mean, we go at midnight mass in Christmas, you know.
Yes. I don't know how old I was, but I was a little mischievous. One time I remember my mom was washing clothes, you know, on the washboard, and there was other people around, but anyway, for some reason, I decided I wanted to start a fire. I went to the backyard and poured some gasoline. I don't know where I got it from, but poured some gasoline on the grass and just light a fire. My mom and the other ladies came running with buckets of water to turn it off.
There was a few times we used to hear noises up in the attic. and we didn't know what it was. So my mom told Bush, go up in the attic and see where that noise is coming from. So he looked all around them, and there was nothing. The only thing he found was a picture of my grandmother. So once he brought the picture down, that was it. We never heard any noises after that.
One time, there in the country, at my tío José's house, we had a chicken coop, a big chicken coop. She had a lot of chickens, and one time I remember my mom told me to go get some eggs. I was just gonna reach over to get some eggs, and as I was gonna reach my hands over, I heard my mother's voice. She called me Tita. So I pulled away, I didn't get the egg. I went running to the house, and I asked my mom, what did you want? She goes, nothing. I says, why? I says, you call me. She goes, no, I didn't call you, mija. I says, yes, you did. I heard you. I heard you call me, Mom. She goes, no, I didn't. So after I found out she didn't call me, I went back to what I was doing. And as I was going to put my hand in there, in that thing, to get the egg, there was a big snake with her mouth wide open. It was a garden angel. If I would have put my hand in there, the snake would have bitten me.
Yes, I do remember when I used to live in Edcouch, I used to have a friend. She was white and I was dark. I guess because I was in the sun a lot. And I do recall they would call her the Whitey, and they would call me Little Black Sambo. They used to tease me, Little Black Sambo. Okay.
It was mostly just us family. It was mostly us family. This was like in, growing up, this farm was like in the 50s. And we had people that would come from Mexico to pick cotton at the farm during cotton picking time. The rancher there, he had several houses where the people could stay. And some had family, some had kids. So we played with their kids when they came over.
Porque supe que tenías otro amante, y en Laredo ya tenías otros dos. Te gusta mucho el baile, y bailas al compás.
We went to La Villa, and most all of us boys, we played basketball at La Villa. And we were pretty decent basketball players, so when we went to Edcouch, the coach that we had in La Villa, he would go down to La Villa, to Edcouch, and kind of visit out there and got us going in there. And so it was pretty nice. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, my brother Ventura played basketball, and I think he might have played baseball too. And Greg and Roy played basketball.
We used to have to take the bus to school, which was maybe like about 5 miles away from where we at the farm where we were. One thing that we used to do as boys, we were a little embarrassed carrying our lunch, so we made our oldest sister, Dominga, carry the lunch for all of us. Out of 30 kids, I ended up being the valedictorian, and the speech that I had to give, you know, I didn't know I was gonna have to do it, but they gave me this speech that I still remember the last three or four sentences of it, you know. But a friend of mine knew, and he knew that I was gonna give this speech, and he came that night with a sport jacket so I could look presentable, you know, because here I am, a farm boy with not decent clothes, you know.
I remember last time too when we went to Texas, I don't know if you know Juan Silva, his dad, he told us a story that we had never heard. He says that one time he knew my dad, and he says one day him and another guy were working in the field close by where we used to walk from the bus to the house, and he said the guy told him, look at the bus, must have broken down. He goes, why? He goes, well, look at all those kids walking there. It must have been like 5 or 6 of us. And the guy told him, shh, callate, son los hijos de Felix. You know, they were never aggressive, but I was. If somebody fought with them or something, I'd get in there and do something.
It was fun. You know, we used to play volleyball. We used to have PE at school, you know. But we had to hide from my brothers, because we were not allowing pee. We had to wear shorts. And at that time, our brothers, Ventura and Roy, wouldn't let us wear shorts. So every time we were out in pee, if by any chance Roy was out there in the gym, oh, we would get in trouble, or Ventura. We had to hide from them, but we had no choice because pee was required. And I remember one time that I'll never forget. We used to get pedal. I used to get pedal a lot, and I survived. I remember the principal peddled us because it was me and a couple of friends. We were going to go play hooky. It was in lunchtime, and we decided to go to Delta Lake. It was, I don't know how far, but anyway, we were walking. We're in town walking, and here comes the principal. He drove by. He goes, "What are you kids doing?" "Oh, nothing, nothing, nothing. Get in the car." He got us in the car. It was about three or four of us. I don't remember. He took us to the office and bent over and bow. He paddled us. I don't know how many times.
Yeah. In high school, at that time, me and Janie were the only Mexican people in our high school, believe it or not.
Which high school?
Rainier Beach High School. When I was in school, my friends at work, they laughed at me because, believe it or not, I got into trouble in school. I got suspended from school. I got into a fight in school. It wasn't my fault, so I'll you know, say that first of all. We were standing by in the hall. It was lunch, during the lunch. I was standing by our lockers, and then these three black girls walked by. So then the girls go, they walk by, and then she goes, "What did you say to me?" I go, "I didn't say nothing." He goes, "Yeah, you said something." I go, "No, I didn't say nothing." He goes, "Yeah, tell me what you said." I go, "I didn't talk to you. I didn't say nothing." So she kicked me. I kicked her back, and we started fighting. Of all the times I never wore skirts, I always wore pants, I had a skirt that day. Well, anyway, I was on the floor. I was banging her, and I had her on the floor. And all of a sudden, I see blood on the floor. Like, oh, my God, she's already bleeding. So I went like that. It was me that was bleeding. So all of a sudden, they broke us up. They took us to the superintendent and the principal. And then our counselor said, you know, they suspended her for 2 weeks, and they suspended me for 1 week. And one of the girls, one of her friends is the one that cut my eyebrow with a fork. I don't know where she got it. Anyway, and the girl that really got into a fight, she was really scared. She goes, "Hey, girl, I didn't cut you. I'm sorry." And then I go, "Don't tell me. I'll tell." So then, anyway, to make it short, the counselor says, "Well," he goes, "did you learn anything about it?" I go, "Yeah." I go, "See, if anybody picks on me, I'm going to get into a fight again." He goes, "You don't learn." I go, "Hey, nobody's going to defend me. I got to defend myself."
For fun, you know, I always enjoy dancing, you know, on the weekends over there in Texas, you know, there were cities, you know, that they always had bands that were very popular, especially like Spanish music, you know. And there were also good bands that they would come and play in, whether it was in Edcouch, Elsa, or West Laco, all those cities that were, you know, pretty close to where I live. For some reason, you know, like the people, like I was from Edcouch, Elsa. If I was go to another city like West Laco, which was only like 10 miles from where we used to live, the guys from that other city, when they see a stranger, that somebody that didn't belong there, they would try to kind of run you out of there. You know, they didn't want to see people from other cities go to their city and be dancing with girls from that city. So sometimes there would be fights, you know, and everything. So you had to be kind of careful, you know. Sometimes, you know, it wasn't one on one. You know, there was always a little gangs. You know, they would if you were in a fight, you wouldn't be fighting with one guy. You know. There would have been maybe like four or five more, and probably more at times you probably would lose, you know, getting beat up, you know.
Yeah, it was very, very popular dances. Leo Joe, Agustin Ramirez, Hilberto Perez, Don La Rosa, Rubén Vela, Ramon Ayala, Agustin Gallardo, Pepe Maldonado. If you dared, you were a stranger. They looked at, cuñado, where are you from? I just, oh, just at a little ranch here outside West Laco, you know. You know, but I show no fear, nothing. The way I didn't give myself away the way. I just, no, I live right here in the ranch. I'll be honest, it was sports. Basketball was my favorite sport, best time I had. I enjoyed going to school. My grades in school were not that great, you know, but barely just the level. And I like girls, but I was too shy. I thought they would say no, and I was a bit embarrassed, you know. And I used to go to dances, but I would just watch from the outside. I saw, look at that, they play like monkeys, no way. Then when I finished high school, I started going to the dance in the Veras Palladium, and I kind of like it, and that's where I met my wife, Stefana.
And I remember, you know, we used to go swimming at midnight. I mean, it's hard to believe, and my mother would always tell us, boys, be careful, I don't want to go swimming at night, you know. One night, you know, we went swimming there, and it was, my brother Greg was there, myself. There were about five or six of us, you know, that were swimming in the canal, you know. And we were just having a great time, you know, swimming. You know, there was a gate there where we would climb that gate that opens the water, and we would get on top of that and dive into the water there. And during that time, we heard somebody that was coming, you know, and we thought it was gonna be the man that's in charge of the canal man, you know. But we kind of froze and said, somebody's coming. So everybody stopped swimming. So we were wondering what was going on. And all of a sudden, you know, we turned to one side and there was a little trail. We saw like a woman dressed in a white gown, you know, and it didn't seem like she was walking, but like kind of floating, you know. And all of a sudden, whatever it was, you know, stopped right where the gate is. And then she kind of floated way up to the top of the gate. And we didn't see the face, but we could see the gown and all that, you know. We dove into the water, you know, and when he hit the water, we heard a splash. And as soon as we heard the splash, oh, talking about running out of there, everybody's panic, you know. We started yelling, and I mean, I don't know, we were crying. We, at the time, we didn't have any, of course, we didn't have any swimming trunks or anything like that. We were not in Corrocas. But anyway, we just, we got out of that canal so fast that we ran to the house of my friends. And we were yelling and screaming, and I tell you, I don't know, some of us were crying or anything, but we ran so fast that we forgot our clothes, you know. That was, you know, that was a lesson for us, you know. We don't know, and I don't know, there were stories that say that he could have been La Llorona.
I got out of high school when I was senior in January, so I didn't finish the year, and went in the military, and I got my GED in the military. But I had a friend that we were real good friends, and we kind of talked it over and said, well, let's go to the military. And we were going to go to the Air Force, both of us. And then, but we ended up going in the Marines. Just because I had heard that, you know, in the military, you know, you get to go to different places and maybe get more experience, get more exposure to whatever, there might be better jobs. Yeah. And I like the training. For one reason, yeah, I always like to exercise a lot, so that was one of the reasons. I knew the Marines had the toughest training. I did my boot camp in San Diego, and then from San Diego, I went to, they sent me to station to Camp Del Mar by Oceanside, California. And I was there for about a year and a half. And then after that, I went to Okinawa, and I was there about another year and a half. Then I came back, and I was stationed at El Toro, which is an air wing out of Santa Ana, California. And I did my 4 years and got out.
I graduated in 1959, and I tried to look for work at there's a place called Texas Plastics and Rotel Cannery. It was canning tomatoes, but what I found out is that you didn't have anybody working in that area who could give put in a good word for you. You almost had no chance. One of their questions they would ask me is, how are you with the draft board? And I say, well, I'm being classified 1A, which means that I could be drafted. I can't get a job by myself on my own, you know, so I'll join the Army and get it out of the way, you know. That way, when they ask me in an interview for a job, yeah, I already did my time in, you know. I joined the Army, and that's for a three-year stint. I had gone to Germany. When I was in Germany, that's when they built a Berlin Wall that divided East and West Germany. But when I came back, I was ready to get out of the Army. I was discharged in the and ended up in Texas, maybe something like August of 62.
I met a Sergeant E5 in less than 2 years, but I didn't hate it, but I didn't like it to stay as a career. Now I just served my time and that was it. And the good thing that I went to Fort Worth, California, and then I got orders to go to Europe and Germany. I spent my tour in Munich, Germany, and Stuttgart, and quite a small world. When I went, they sent me to Stuttgart temporary duty, working on a shelf, grocery shelves. And I met a friend of mine. It was Mother's Day. I was going to send money to my mom. And I was in the post office. And I was writing down, I had my civilian clothes, and this guy was standing next to me. He was in uniform, you know. And I, as soon as I'm done, I look up, and I read his name, Madrigal. We graduated in 63, and then 67, I think. I met him over there, so I said, hey, have you gone on vacations? I said, no. Let's go to Spain. So we took the train and we went to Barcelona, Spain. And the first time I saw a bullfight, I feel bad. I didn't like it, you know, when I see the spear go right through the bull.
In 1964, the second year when we came to Washington State, there was the, during the Vietnam War, they were starting to draft a lot of kids, you know, to into the service, you know. So I volunteered for the draft, you know. I went and I went to basic training, and I went to Fort Ord, California. And during that time, in 1965, that's when they started sending our troops to Vietnam, you know. And that's when I was with the First Infantry Division, and that's when I was sent to Vietnam from 1965 through 66. Yeah, I was stationed about 15 miles from Saigon. Saigon was the capital of South Vietnam during that time. And it was tough, you know. I mean, nobody likes to go to war, you know, but during that time, you know, when you're in the military, you have to serve, you know. I mean, you do what they tell you. And I just wanted to serve my country, and I did the best I could, you know. I was, thank God, you know, that I made it back safely, you know, so. And during that time, you know, when I was in Vietnam, I told my sisters and brother, do not tell my mom, you know, that where I'm at, you know, because I, knowing my mom, she would have been worried all the time. I just tell her that I'm fine, you know. So a lot of your friends and, you know, people that you saw that didn't make it back, you know, it was pretty pretty sad, you know. So you lose track of time. I mean, you forget about the days, you know. You just want to think about surviving, you know, trying to do the best and see if you can make it through, you know, and everything. And it's really one of those things, you know, when you're out there in the jungle, I mean, you go out there and because it rains so much over there, you know, you whatever you're wearing, the only thing that I remember, you know, that it's always in my mind that, officers and sergeants would tell us, say, be sure you have some pair of socks, you know, 2 or 3 pair of socks, because it's rained so much, the only part that you probably want to be worrying about keeping dry is your feet, you know, keep them dry, you know, everything. When I went to Vietnam, you know, I thought we were doing the right thing, you know. After it was, when I came back and everything, it was something that I couldn't believe it, you know, how much protest there was during that time. I mean, it's unbelievable, you know, you came here and you felt like you weren't welcome, you know. You weren't welcome, that they shouldn't have been out there, you know. But, you know, when you're in military, you do what you're told, you know. You don't have opinion there as far as saying, hey, I don't wanna be here, I think, you know. You just do what they tell you. And it took a long time, you know. For me, it took a long time for me to adjust to being civilian, you know, because for a long time, for years, even when I was asleep, you know, I was kind of not completely relaxed, and always something on my mind that I would have to be on my toes, you know. Any little noise or anything that would didn't sound right, I would jump up, you know, and be ready, like, as though to defend myself. But it's something that, you know, it's hard to explain.
Soy ranchero, jugador y navegante. Ya me voy para nunca más volver. Me dejaste sin dinero y sin rolante.
I think what happens after I got out of the army, there's a girl that I used to like that lived not too far from where I did. So I decided to go and visit her family, you know. Then we were talking, and they told me, Ventura, you know, you should take your brothers to Quincy, Washington. They pay really good, you'll find a lot of work. While I was in the army and I was sending that money back home, I would write and ask Roy or whoever, how much money do you have, or how you guys don't get along? Yeah, we got enough money. But what he did was he bought a car, you know, Mercury. And what happened is that we used that Mercury to come to Quincy It was myself, Roy, Minga, and Janie. The funny thing on that car was that it burned a lot of oil. Just about every time we stopped for gas, we had to put a quarter or two of oil, you know. Mm-hmm. But it got us to Quincy okay. It was around February of the following year, 63. When we were actually going to Quincy, we stopped at, I think it was called Chip Rock, New Mexico, for gas. Then there's some black people there, you know. They ask us, where are you going? Oh, we're going to Quincy. Say, okay, you'll get there, Friday. Next week! And then they started laughing, like they were joking. It's going to take us a long time to get there. Our first job was with, the Medranos, with the family that I mentioned, that the girl that I used to like. And when we got to Quincy, we stayed with them for about two or three weeks, you know. And our first job was planting orchard, apple trees, you know. And it was a little cold, but I think it was me and Roy. And it was fun, you know, working with those people, because the old man, Medrano, he used to talk a lot, make funny jokes, you know, tease the other people, and he kept us kind of happy, you know, working together. We just made two trips, actually. The first trip, and then go back that same year, and then return again the following year. Anyway, I sent money so they could come and join us in Quincy, you know. And that's how Butch and Greg ended up coming to Quincy. But they stayed in El Valle because they had to go to school. It was in February, so they waited until school was over. So I sent money. Okay, you guys take the bus, come join us. But then the Rubios heard about it, and they said, okay, why don't we drive our car and you guys go with us? We'll use the money that Ventura sent you, and we'll go down there too. So that's how they ended up also in Quincy. Mm. Small town, at least they had they had movies, they had a bowling alley. And actually, we did most of the shopping or going to either Wenatchee or Yakima, where they had bigger stores.
No, I really don't know why I even went. And I do remember when I went with them, I got motion sickness in the car. I do remember sitting in the back seat. How I did to Washington, I have no idea. I was just very nauseated, very pale. I couldn't stand that bologna or the Fritos, you know. It was making me sick. I do remember they would say, Janie, roll the window down. Get some air, get some air. I would be out there trying to get my air. But yet I felt like, I'm not going to make it. But I did, you know.
You had to go thin in beats, you know, and they gave you just a half a handle saw to do the work, and it's all, you're bending on your back all day long. There's some people that rode the tractors and were dropping the seeds from the road for the potatoes to go. And that was pretty much all the work that I remember out in the field, you know, other than the work in the potato sheds. I like to say maybe a dollar and a quarter, maybe.
The boys, they left me in Texas, me and Petra, until I was like 10 years old. Then that's when I started coming with them. I did my junior high in Quincy. And in Quincy, we also went to cut cebolla, mota de cebolla. And that was a very bad experience because it's a very stinking place where you go. You cut the onion, the flower of the onion, I guess the pulp, and you put it in sacks. And when you come out, you smell like onion. You can take 2-3 showers and you still have that smell in your body. But I didn't work that much there. Where I did most of my work was when Seattle. During my summer school, they used to have this program, the welfare program, where kids that were being helped by public assistance, they had a summer program where you enlist and every summer you had a job. So from when I was 16 up till I graduated, every summer I used to work in the Seattle Naval Shipyards in the library. So that was my job every summer. I already sat that for 3 years.
I didn't like it. In those years, way back in the 60s, it would snow so bad up to our knees. I didn't like it. We were not used to the snow, you know, but evidently, I think we had no choice. But my dream was always of going back, but it never happened. Mm-hmm. And evidently, I guess we just, you know, got used to it. As the time went by, we got used to it. we all started working, and it was, you know, for a better life. Compared to the life we had up there, it was, you know, my first job, I think it was thinning beets, yeah, and then thinning apples, potato warehouse, and then we started working for Lamb Weston, which is our ride on right now.
Por el mundo te me echaste a correr, te gusta mucho el baile, y bailas al compás, te vas hasta Laredo, y quieres más y más.
Lupe, you know, Lupe, being the oldest, you know, he was the oldest, and he always thought, you know, that, well, he's the oldest one. If I need advice or something, I go to him, you know, he was always, he's there, he's the oldest. If I needed permission from someone, I would go to him and ask him.
Lupe was, he was in the Marines, and he was proud to be a Marine.
Lupe, I remember him in school, you know, as we were growing up, and then I remember him going to the service, you know, he had a girlfriend named Imelda Garza, and I remember, you know, when Lupe went to the service, he had a Japanese girlfriend out there, her name was Izuku Onyo, and me, to get back at Lupe's girlfriend at school time, she would sit there by us, or I would see her close by, and I would say, oh, my brother has a girlfriend. My brother Lupe has a Japanese girlfriend. Her name is Izuku Onyo, and I would get her mad.
Lupe, okay. Lupe was kind of too much of a quiet, reserved on the side, you know. So, but I do have the memory where, you know, he brought me that Japanese, you know, doll in the box, and you know, and then one memory I have to also too is when he was dating Reina. They have where, you know, you're not allowed to go with your boyfriend anywhere out without an escort or anything. So then I had to drive back with them, you know, just to escort them. So I was actually the escort of Reina, and in Lupe.
Oh, yeah. He kind of was more of a disciplinary for the rest of the brothers and sisters. He kind of, especially for the sisters, he had restrictions for them. And I wasn't too tough with him like he was. You know, he put a little more restrictions for the girls.
Ventura, you know, Ventura had the same, almost like Lupe, but Ventura was a little bit more restrictive. He was really on top of the thing. He would be the one that would punish us if we did something wrong, you know. Ventura, you know, he used to be in track, you know, he was fast, you know, as a matter of fact. When I would get in trouble, and for some reason I was always getting in trouble. I remember if I was doing something wrong and Ventura would tell me something, hey, you better straighten out, or you better, and if I would start saying, I would start running, trying to get away from that, he would tell me, he said, don't run because I will catch you and then you're going to get a beating.
He was like a second little father to us. Yeah, from day one, ever since I remember, Ventura has always been there for us. Ventura, he was strict with us, you know. If we didn't go to church on Sundays, we were not allowed to go nowhere. We had to stay home. We would have to go to church every Sunday. And then if we didn't go, we wanted to go to the movies. Nope, you didn't go to church. He was real strict with us. We couldn't wear nail polish. Me and Minga were always buying nail polish. And if Ventura saw us, he would get our polish and throw it a clear across the field. You know, and then after Ventura left, me and Minga would go out there in the fields and get the polish. He was always in front for us, taking care of us, you know, making all the decisions and everything, taking us to work and everything. And every summertime, he would give me and Minga a certain amount of money, and him and the boys a certain amount of money, to buy school clothes to last us for the whole year. I think he would give us $100, and that would buy shoes, clothes, everything for the school year.
Ay, Ventura, he's like a second father to me. I mean, he got me out of trouble so many times. Especially when I got out of school, he would always take me, you know, most of the time I was with him. When he got married, I would go spend some time with them at where he lived. They lived in this apartment where the train would go by. You could hear all that rattle on the floor where he used to live. And, you know, a lot of memories I have with him. But, you know, man, he also gave me the name of Bubblegum.
Roy, all I remember was when he went into the military. You know, of course, he was in Vietnam. He would write to me. He would send me pictures, you know, but he would tell me, do not tell mother or others that I am in Vietnam.
Roy, he was, the mischievous one of the whole family. He always get in some kind of trouble, him and his brother Greg. Roy and Greg, they fought a lot, and Ventura had always had to go out there and discipline.
Roy, I can remember Roy used to take me to the dances, so I was happy. Because I liked to dance, and he would take me and my cousin Anita to the dances. So he was, I think he was a little mischievous too. Yeah. I don't know if he told you, but there was one time that him and Greg were fooling around and throwing a file, those metal files, the big ones that have a point.
Roy, yeah, he used to pick on me all the time, you know. One time we were working in the fields and with the hose, and he had a file, and I was about maybe about 10 yards or something. And he said, "Hey, Greg, here, catch it." And I saw it, and I just spin around. Whammo, he hit me right here. So he carried me and took me home, and then my uncle said, "Oh, you better go to the doctor, you know." And then now, when I remember him, he was always getting mad, you know. We were boxing, and I was beating him in boxing, and he got mad. So he went up and boom, right here. And I still got a little mark, you know.
He would follow me. I would tell him, "Hey, let's go over here, let's do this." But he would hesitate a little bit more. He would say, "Well, we better not, we might get in trouble." And I would tell him, "Hey, don't worry, I'll take care of it. You just do what I tell you, you know." And he would, and then after, and for doing, for listening to me, sometimes he would get punished too.
We used to play, we were little, we were still at my father's house. You know, my father was still alive. We had a little house, a playhouse. We used to pretend. Roy was Roy Rogers, Greg was Gene Autry. And we'd all play cowboys, you know. And Roy, I remember one time Roy told Greg, "Hey, Greg, Gene Autry died." Oh, Greg started crying like a baby. Yeah, but he would take care of us, you know. Greg was something else. As teenagers, he was always after us, making sure which boys we talked to, which boys were good, and which were, them pachucos, you know. We would say, "Oh, the pachucos from Quincy," and blah, blah, blah. And they used to call him the Hawks. They used to call Greg in Quincy, you know, our friends, you know, the guys, they used to call, "Here comes the Hawks, that's your brother."
Greg used to play basketball, and I know he went into the army. He was stationed in Germany. Greg, I remember Mom saw this little chicken and told him, "Oh, go throw him over there, mijo, because the chicken is dead," you know. So then he goes over with the little chicken and put it in the cactus. Yeah, by noonish, yeah, after it got warm, here comes this little chicken trying to, had all these little thorns, that cactus being it wobbling over to the house. "Mom," Greg said, "Mom, look, the chicken was not dead, you know."
Greg, well, one time he went fishing, he got a big tiburon. We had a lot of fish meat for a lot of time. And he always, his favorite sodas were the Big Reds. But he always used to buy Big Red sodas and drink one or two by himself, you know. So yeah, he was really funny. I mean, you could never finish the stories with Greg.
Minga was, she was the old one, and she helped Mom a lot. Yeah, but she was the, since she was the oldest one, she had to learn most of a lot of the housework. Mm-hmm. She kind of helped discipline most of her younger sisters. Mm-hmm. And she loved to play sports, but your Uncle Ventura, he wouldn't let her play. She would want to play soccer or baseball. It was a catcher. Yeah, but we're not playing catcher.
Minga was our trooper. Yeah, she was, I would say, Uncle Severo's favorite niece.
We'll tell Minga, I say, "Hey, you carry my lunch, and then during my lunchtime, you can give it back to me." Or, and she would do that, you know. I mean, she was she's a wonderful sister, you know. And then she would also take care of us, make sure, you know, that everybody was had their lunch and everything was okay with.
Yeah, she was a good cook, you know, and after now, she's a good cook. Yeah, but Minga in school, she used to take care of all the brothers, you know. She was, you know, defending on the brothers. You know, they used to bully Roy and Greg at school, the kids, and here would come Minga fighting over them, you know, beating them up because they were fighting with the boys, with Greg and Roy.
She was probably the mischievous one of the girls. She usually, mostly, if anybody got in trouble, it was her.
She had a temper, I think, Petra. But she meant well. She tried to get away with not doing the work as far as out in the fields, but to me, none of them escaped. They had to work.
My grandma used to be feisty. I think it was just, that's where your mom gets it from. One time she said when they were teenagers, they wanted to go to a dance and her dad didn't want to take them. And she was so mad and I don't know what she did. She wasn't doing what she was supposed to do, so he wouldn't take her to the dance. They left her at the house and I guess they locked the door or something and through the window she was yelling at her sister, her name was Victoria, and her dad, you better take me to the dance or I'm going to kill myself. I'm going to drown myself. They didn't take her, but you know, Tita, she was a stubborn one.
Petra, she's the one that we spent most of the time, especially because that's where they used to live us over there, me and Petra. And I have a lot of memories, Petra. I remember when we used to go to the movies with her, me and Petra. And also, she was going to be in a talent show. And I remember she wanted to leave early, and my mom, she hadn't taken a bath yet. So she goes, hurry up, I have to be there. And then she goes, I'm going by myself. No, you're not. Yes, I'm going by myself, you know. And uncle said, no, you're not going. So he got the belt, and he chased her, and he was hitting her. I go, don't hit her. Until finally my mom got out of the shower, and then we left. And the song I don't never forget is the song that your mom sang was, I didn't know the gun was loaded. I'm so sorry, my friend.
He was the youngest guy, and he was pretty mellow. I think he was the only one that went to school beyond high school. He went to community college.
He didn't have to do chores that we did, you know, because he was the youngest. So I think he got away with a lot of things that he didn't have to do, you know.
He saved my life one time. this guy, and we got into the fight, and I couldn't get up, you know. And I started crying, you know. And Bush came and he beat him up, you know. So I said, man, why did I do that for? What did I cry for? Yeah, and he also was the one that was more into mechanic, and he went to Spokane, I think. Then after that, he went to Chicago, so he was gone for quite a while. We miss him a lot, you know.
Bush, remember one time, we were at Tio Jose's house. We used to have a lot of chickens, and they had this saying that if when the chicken was going to hatch eggs or have babies, you would dunk them in a tub of water, you know, and they wouldn't have the babies no more. So one time, me and Bush, we got a big tub of water, we filled it up, and we went and grabbed this white chicken, a big fat white chicken we had, and we started playing with the chicken, dunking her in the water, and the poor chicken would go up, and then we'd get her up, and we're laughing, and then we would dunk her again, and the poor chicken was just going like this, drowning, and until the end, the chicken just went limp, and I says, oh, and then we got scared, Bush, we drowned the chicken.
Sometimes, she catches things wrong. You mean in one way, but she thinks a little different. Sometimes you have to kind of explain her a little more in detail, otherwise she gets it wrong, whatever you try to do.
And also, she would hang around also with Minga and Petra, and she would do whatever they told her, you know, and she was also kind of following them.
I remember JD, pretty much when we were little with my father, she was too small. Going to grade school, she was real timid, Janie. You know, pretty much real quiet. I do remember one time she killed some kitties. We had some at Tio Jose's house. We had a whole bunch of kitties. And there was this baby kitty out the window, and she got a big brick. And she was looking out through the window, and she threw the brick at the cat. And she killed that cat, and she says she don't remember it. I think she does.
Santos is a happy-go-lucky girl. She was my... the youngest, so I kind of favor her more.
So being that she was a baby of the family, you know, she was always she got away with a lot of things. She didn't have to do anything.
Santos, we used to play together. We used to play jumping rope, you know, and little dolls, and we'd play with little mud, you know, and a little tin cup, you know, tin that the lost vegetables, you know, those are little dishes, you know.
Over there in Texas, I remember Santos making her first communion, going to school also. Pretty much Santos, you know, just stayed home.
was in Monterey, Cadereyta, I think, in this town, Monterey. And he grew up while he was when he was a teenager. That was when the revolution was going on, and he got caught in that because the groups that were fighting with Santana and Pancho Villa, they drafted you, they took you away, and you were part of the army. I think he did that for about a year, him and his brothers, because he had four brothers.
I know he was born in Mexico, and I think he said General Terán. I don't know whether that's a state or just a small town. I know he was in the in the military, and he was under a general called Carranza. He was good at throwing a knife, you know, that he could throw a knife and hit his target. He said that one time he got kind of trapped, or they surrounded him, and somehow he managed to escape, you know. I don't know how, but he said he escaped. Mm-hmm. Also, when we had floods, there's a lot of water, there's a lot of those fish called gar. He built a spear to catch them, you know. A spear, and they had a rope tied to it, and they're good eating, you know. Mm-hmm. After he got out of the military, he moved to Texas, and my mother, Uncle Severo and Uncle Jose were very young when they came to Texas with my grandmother, great uncle, and another great aunt. I think my mother was maybe 3 years old, and Uncle Severo was maybe about a year old. And they had been living in Texas since that time, you know. Mm-hmm. And he probably met her, but she was in her 30s, I think. And
he was getting a little strict on us, you know. He would, when he'd tell us something to do, he would maybe tell us twice. He didn't obey. He did the way he was telling you. Then he probably took the belt and gave you a belt, you know. He was a family man. He worked hard all the time. He didn't drink, he only smoked.
He was the foreman of this place where he used to work, but the people around town that would talk about him say he was a well-respected person, you know. In those days, you could buy groceries on credit and pay at the end of the week when you get paid, you know. If Lupe or I or any of us, Herreras, went to the store to buy on credit, just put it on the tab that my dad would come and pay anyway. Also, I remember this person that used to sell candy, and he would go to the farms, and then one day he stopped at our house, and my dad happened to be there, and he asked him if he would give the credit, and the person said no. Then get out of here. I don't want to see you. He really got upset at him. And us being mean guys too, every time we saw him, stick our dogs on him, make the dogs chase him.
My father, you know, every Saturday he would take me and Ventura to the movies. It was every single Saturday. Me and Ventura, first to the movies, and then we would go out to eat maybe hamburgers. That was hamburgers now. As I recall, at first I didn't know what they were, you know, but. And then on Sundays he would take the rest of the family to the movies and my mom. We used to go to school there. We had lots of fun, you know, growing up, you know, and my father, you know, he was a real hardworking man. He used to wear military boots, the ones that you tighten up. He would used to wear jeans and a blue shirt and a cowboy hat. I remember for my birthdays, you know, he would always buy me a coconut cake. And he was always taking me wherever he went to the store, wherever he was. I was always there with him. He used to tell me, you know, that he wanted me to learn how to drive a tractor. I want you, when you grow up, you know, to learn how to drive a tractor. So we'd go up and down the fields and, you know, driving the tractor.
I was 13 when he passed away, yeah. I don't exactly remember for sure 100%, but I know he had a tooth, wisdom tooth taken out. His jaw was pretty swollen. And my understanding is they're not supposed to take it out when it's swollen. They have to give some medication to let the swelling go down, then they'll take it out. And I think they were never able to stop the bleeding for I don't know what reasons. And that kind of led to his passing away. Well, it was very sad because, you know, everybody was just used to seeing him around. And he was he provided us with everything, and so yeah, it was tough. Yeah, and it was a lot tougher on my mom too, because my mom, she didn't know how to read or write.
It was pretty hard on us. I think a mother took it the hardest. But it was, she would cry real loud. What am I gonna do with here? All my kids are so small and so young, and she would really cry loud. And then I used to try to be the brave guy. He had a tooth extracted. I don't know why he bled to death, you know, because they couldn't stop the bleeding. There's some tales, some folk, like I say, I'd say folk tales. A friend said that the moon was at a certain time, you know, that it shouldn't have happened, you know, had the tooth extracted. We moved to my Uncle Jose's farm, you know. He had a small house. I think the person that my dad used to work for went and got aid for us, like welfare. Every time I think about it, I get a little upset, because in those days, I think we're just getting like either $98 or $96 a month. Right now it's not much money, you know, but still in those days, I don't think it was much money for a family of, here's 10 of us. Mm-hmm. So that's why you also had to work on weekends.
When he passed away, I was gonna be 9 that year. Yeah, and I remember that they had him in a coffin there by the window, you know, and with a little thing to kneel, because they used to keep him at the house, not at the mortuary, for 2 or 3 days, I think it was 3 days, you know. And I remember we used to go and kneel and, you know, see him, but my mom would tell us that he was asleep. And we had never seen a dead person, so we didn't know the difference, you know. But, you know, we would wonder, because how come he's not getting up? Or to me, you know, because I don't know how everybody else felt about, you know, death, you know. But I do remember my mom would be crying a lot when people came to see us, you know, see her. So, you know, as well, something's not right. But maybe it's God's way of keeping us, you know, going on, because we didn't know what was really wrong, you know.
Okay, I never met my father because, you know, I was 1 year old, a little over 1 year when he passed away. I used to have dreams about him. One time I dreamed, and he was with Greg, and I said, I never saw his face. And I remember Greg saying, "Apa, this is su hija Santitos." And then he said, "No, eso no es Santitos, está muy feita." I wanted to see, I had this, you know, ojalá Dios que, you know, I want to see him. Believe it or not, I dreamed him. I had this dream that dad was in a coffin, and I was looking at him, and all of a sudden I see that his chest, that he's breathing. And I told Ventura, dad is alive. Look, he's breathing. He goes, "No." He goes, "Yeah, he is." And all of a sudden he sits up, and they go, "He's alive. He's alive." I went, I hugged him. I mean, I saw him with a, you know, kind of like thin face, you know. And then I said, "Papá, es usted, dice, sí, mija, soy yo." And then he goes, "Papá, dice, sabe que mamá está muy malita." He says, "Sí, mija, yo sé." He says, "Tu mamá está muy malita." And then I asked him, "Is it true that they say that from up there in heaven you can see everybody?" He goes, "Oh, sí, mija, I can see everybody. I know everything about you all. I see everybody." I go, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." And he told me, and I'll never forget this. I even told Roy, he goes, "Tell your brother Roy to go have a doctor's checkup, because there's something wrong with his stomach." And believe it or not, a couple of years later after that, Roy had an operation. He had something wrong with his stomach. And then I told him about that dream. He goes, "You know what? It was really true."
My mother, you know, she was something else. She was a great mom too, you know. She was always very dedicated, you know. I mean, always caring for the kid, for the children, always cooking for us, washing clothes and everything. It's so hard to imagine, you know, how my mom, you know, how hard she had to work. I don't ever remember her sitting down, you know, and relaxing and taking it easy. And she was always doing something, cooking, washing clothes, being outside, but she was always working.
She didn't know English or very much. She didn't know anything, you know, but she struggled, but she survived, you know. She was real, real, real polite, friendly. She didn't want to hurt anybody, you know, spank him or not, you know. And that was the reason she didn't want to get married, because, no, if I get married, this man might beat up my kids too, you know. So she decided not to get married anymore. We went to, from Edcouch, we went to San Juan, maybe about 10 miles, you know. And she used to work with us, and I was like, wow, how did we make it? I mean, it's a long way, and mom, she worked slower, you know. But we made it, you know. She put the girls, Petra and Minga, to work, you know. They helped her out, you know. They also made the food for us, you know. I'm very grateful she took care of us, you know. Long family, survival, struggling, but she did it.
She was real quiet, I mean, real, she always depended on us and all that. I mean, taught us that respect your elders, respect, you know, other people. And, you know, even my, when we went to Texas, my uncle used to tell her, Ramona, cásate. So, you know, somebody will help you with your kids. And he goes, no, I don't want to get married. I don't want nobody mistreating my kids. And she never wanted to get married. We used to say, who's your favorite son? No, mijo, a todos los quiero igual, you know. No, es cierto. Sí, a todos los quiero igual. You know, she always used to say that. I remember one experience I'll never forget is, I can't remember Escobar, I think it was his name, the owner of the fields where nearby our house. He used to come over, talk to her. They would sit down and have coffee and this and that. So I remember one time when the boys came back from Washington, your mom, Petra, she goes, he goes, mi mamá tiene novio. He says, anda con Escobar. Oh, my God. She goes so mad. She got the belt and ran after her, hit her. He goes, don't say that. It's true. Sí tiene novio.
Since she didn't know how to speak English or write or anything, she couldn't help us with work, you know. But she was a gentle person. My mom didn't, like I said, she didn't know anybody's birthday or any of that. So we never celebrated birthdays. We didn't, no presents, no cake, nothing like that, but it was nothing that we missed because we weren't around other people that, you know, had a birthday parties or they had cake or this and that. See, my dad, I don't think he ever got a citizenship. At that time, they used to have like a mica, maybe a green card for temporary, I'm not sure what it was for, but, and so did my mom.
She had been living in a nursing home for quite a while, but it was sad, you know, that she had a pain on her knees that she couldn't walk, you know. It's a little hard, I mean, to take, you know, but as family, you know, stick together and... Mm-hmm. Well, he was like a father figure even before my dad died, because, like I say, he used to work for this other farmers or for what they call it, troquero, a guy who have his truck, take people to work, you know. If he saw us, me and Lupe, working at a field, and he would bring us either something to drink or something sweet, you know. And while we were eating or drinking, he would be doing the work, you know. He was always like that. He always trying to be caring for us, even before my dad died. Mm-hmm. Then, like you said, after he died, he became more like the real father figure. That he was always there for us, and most of the money that he had was towards the family in the house.
Tio Severa, you know, Tio Severa could have gotten married. He never got married, you know. When my father died, you know, and like I said, I was 11 years old. When my father died, you know, my mother, she was lost, you know, because my dad would do everything. I mean, he would work, he would provide for the family. My mother was a housewife, you know, she would always be at home taking care of the kids, you know. And my Uncle Joe, who had a farm there in Edcouch, when my dad died, he's the one that took us over there to his farm, and we stayed at his farm. But my Uncle Severo, he was always with helping my mom, you know. Uncle Severo, yeah, you know, he didn't have to do all that, but he loved all of us. He was very proud of all of us, and we're very grateful that we had such a wonderful uncle, you know.
Mm-hmm. Just like he's a second father to us. Every time he used to go to Wisconsin or, you know, all the places he used to go work, when he come back, he would come back with a whole bunch of crayons, paper, pencils, and, you know, he would bring us a lot of stuff. But one thing I'll never forget is one time he was riding me in his bicycle. He would always give me rides in his bicycle. Well, for some way, how my foot got cut in between the tire, and I got cut, and my mom was so mad at him. And one thing he always used to tell me, he goes, Santitos, cántame el Rancho Alegre. And he would give me 5 cents, you know, for to sing him the song. And Every time I used to go to Seattle also when he was in the nursing home or before that, I go, tío, le dije, ¿qué quiere que le traiga? Un reloj, mijita, un reloj. He always wanted a watch. And he was always had these sayings, you know, makeup sayings. And como, like when Julio came, he saw him and goes, oh, pelón, pelón pelaca, hijo de los urracas. Or when I went to visit him in the nursing home, as we were leaving, he told Minga, y te bañas. So there's so many, many memories of him, you know. But every time we would go to a nursing home, he would always have something to give us.
Ila loves sports. Ever since he was 5 years old, he would want to be playing with Chris, you know, soccer or basketball, you know. He was one of those talented players. I remember him trying to compete at this Olympic, you know. Chris didn't make it, but Eli did, but because he was so little, he was such a loving child, and he was a very, you know, good soccer player, you know. When he was going to grade school, well, kindergarten, you know, they would notice the teachers, you know, they would tell us, oh, okay, he would be falling asleep. There were days we would spend with him, you know, before he would go to school, and I still have to record his voice, you know. And he would be reading, you know, so when he would have a test, you know, he would be okay. And he did real good. But then by 7 years old, so then we took him to our family doctor. He went ahead and referred him to the pediatrologist. So, okay, he went to the pediatrologist and he did saw a problem in his eye. And so he showed us, you know, the film. He says, I do show that he does have a brain tumor. So then I remember he was going to catechism to do his first communion. They say, okay, we will let him go for the weekend to do his first communion because his surgery was in the afternoon. You know, he went in and, of course, you know, I was in tears, you know. And what really helped me was that he said not to cry, you know, not to cry, that God was going to take care of him, that he even had an angel, and he even named his angel, and his name is Steve, do not cry, you know. Yes, so, you know, this is, I guess, what has helped me so much, that, you know, like he prepared me, I don't know, but he did told me not to cry, you know. God was going to take care of him. There's an angel waiting for him. His name was Steve. So after his surgery, he never came out of coma. He never did. He never came out. He was in coma for days, you know, and he just had aneurysm. My whole life changed. Things were not the same anymore. The four of us would sit together, and there was a chair there, and I know it was an empty chair. But I am very thankful to God that he gave us all those wonderful years with us, even though it was short years, 7 years. I thank God.
Ya me voy, ahí te dejo en San Antonio. As long as we keep being the way we are, we're all family. We're all pretty attached, you know. All the families, they, you know, they get along fine, you know, and they're all very respectful. All their parents, you know, all the kids and everything, and they get to see that everybody is very close. All the families are close. So I think that kind of helps everybody, because when like we have a reunion, get everybody together, then everybody sees that everybody gets along so fine and everything, and they're always looking forward to reunions because they want to see, you know, each other, because most of them are living distance far away, you know.
Oh, our values are that learn how to respect your elders. That's one thing. Respect your elders. And also one thing I remembered, Roy said that, and I'll never forget, when Mom passed away, he goes, Mija, we don't have to, you know, we don't have to worry about it. The good thing about it is Mom, we're happy about it, because we never saw her suffer from her sickness or saying she never suffered if any of us saying that we're in jail or on drugs or any of that thing. They didn't have, she didn't, she never had that, you know, that she never had to worry about us about anything. And when she lived a normal, you know, simple life. But we're happy that none of us gave her that trouble where, you know, he didn't make her sick, didn't depress her or anything like that. So that's one thing that I'm happy about. We're happy about me, us. And that's what Roy says. He goes, we have to be happy about that. We never gave you any trouble. That she went away peacefully, you know. And, you know, that's one thing that I passed on to my nephews and everything, my son, everything. Learn how to respect your elders. Learn how to respect people and, you know, stay out of trouble. And look towards each other for help.
Right. It'll be nice if they stay in contact with each other and just have a good time when you get together, you know. Try to be there for all of us. I mean, just carry those values as far as getting together whenever possible, you know, and just get to know each other, feel and be there, support them in whatever. Say they're in a bad situation or they get into a trouble, okay, let's help him out or together as a family, you know, no matter what, through good times and bad times. Remember, you're blood related, so also be aware that everybody makes mistakes, nobody's perfect. That's one thing that we should all remember. Don't say he's this or that, no. You're not the judge. It happened this way, so it happened. So everybody makes mistakes. Nobody's perfect.
The caring that our mom did for us, you know, the love, her faith, respect one another. Be there for one another. Someone is in need of help or just to talk to, you know, be there for that person, even though you can't do much, just be around, listen to him, because that sometimes hurt, helps, especially when you're hurting, you know, something to talk about, because that's the way I find myself when I talk to your mom, you know, just somebody to listen to. Yes, cause I feel like she's like a mother to me, you know. Maybe because I didn't talk very much to my mother, you know, if I had about my problems, you know, or nothing. I thank you very much. I like this interview, and, you know, God bless you for all this that you've done for that family. And keep up the tradition, the Herrera family tradition. Keep it on, you know. This is the only way that I see that the family will stay together, stay connected.
Just like I say, you know, all family always come first. And all, and the thing is, the main thing is, adelante los Herreras, you know, and the very best, you know, and everything. And I'm so... I don't know, I'm just so happy to have such a wonderful family, you know, and I see great things, and I thank the Lord for all the blessings that he has given us.
We want them to know, you know, like our stories, mijo. Value their lives, appreciate what they have compared to our lives, you know, what we went through. Appreciate whatever little or whatever little bad or whatever, appreciate it. Go for a better education, you know. Try to achieve, you know, a little higher, go a little higher. And to value and appreciate what the parents or our first generation went through, you know, and keep the tradition of the Herrera, you know, reunion.
Love each other, like I said, and stay close together. Be a tight family, you know, together. Unidos todos, unidos. Try to keep in touch with each other.
Well, just keep on doing the same thing, having those reunions. Keep it going, you know, it's getting strong, you know. Okay. Ventura one, you saved my life. But now, as we're getting older, I think I can save your life now, because they call myself Tarzan. And you don't know why? Because watch, this is the way Tarzan hollers. Ah! And I put the elephants in there too. How about that? And how about those cowboys?